Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you for coming today evening. And we're discussing a series on the Ramayana. Different human lessons that we can learn from various characters in the Ramayana. The Ramayana describes broadly three distinct dynasties. In fact, we could say three different kinds of living beings. There are the Manavas, the Vanaras, and the Rakshasas. There are humans, monkeys, and demons. Now, generally, English words do not really very precisely equate what is described in the scriptures. The word monkey does not really describe the Vanaras, because the Vanaras, many of them are extremely intelligent. And they are best described as celestial apes. They are apes, but they are celestial. Some of them are more intelligent and more powerful than human beings also. Celestial refers to those who live at a higher level of a higher level in the cosmos, belong to the skies or the heavens. And the Rakshasas are not exactly demons, because demon is, at least from the Bhagavad Gita's perspective, it is a mentality. It is not just a race, it's not a racial designation. So technically, the equivalent word of demons would be asuras. Asuri is a mentality. Now, whether the Rakshasas are more precise, they are demons, but you could say demons is like a meta category, and within that, there can be humans also who are demonic. So for example, in the Mahabharata, we have Duryodhan, who is just a human being, like the Pandavas, but he is demonic. So demonic is a mentality, whereas Rakshasa is actually also a physical body. It's also a race. And so Rakshasas are technically, they are what we could call today as cannibals. Cannibals would be man-eaters, people who eat human flesh. And another name that is used for the Rakshasas in the Ramayana is Nisha Chara. Nisha is night. Chara is those who move about. That means that they get strength at night and they attack at night. So while there are different kinds of living beings described in the epics, but overall psychologies are similar everywhere. Ultimately, whichever species one may be in, people want pleasure, they want power, they want the same things that we human beings want. One of my friends is an ethologist. Ethologist is people who study animals, especially in their natural habitat. And he said that animals are just like people. And if there is one big lion in a herd of lions, that lion wants that everybody else should offer their respects to him. So, many of the things that we see in human society, that humans may express them in a particular way, animals also have that. So, even the demons have that. So, Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita describes how the demoniac mentality in the 16th chapter, 13 to 15th verses. And there he says, Idam adyamaya labdham imam prapse manoratham idam asti idam apime bhavishyati punardhanam asaumaya hatah shatrur hanishye chaparanapi ishvaro aham bhogi siddho aham balavan sukhi adhyo abhijanva nasmi konyo asti sadrusho maya Yakshe dasyami modishya ityagyana vimohitaha. So Krishna describes the mentality of the demoniac. And he says, asaumaya hata shatrur. So it begins with idamadyamaya labdham. This much money I have earned now. And this much I earn. I got this scheme and I will earn money in this way. Idam asti idam apime bhavishyati punardhanam. This is greed. So Krishna is actually describing these three verses, increasing demoniac mentality. Wanting wealth is just a natural human desire. And when that becomes excessive, it is greed. But in the next verse, he describes that everybody wants money, but some people, for the sake of money, they are ready to go to any extremes. And what is that extreme he describes? Asau maya hata vishatrur. I have killed this enemy. Hanishe cha paranapi. I will kill that enemy also in the future. And then, in this way, what will happen? I will become God. Ishvaro aham aham bhogi. I am the controller. I am the enjoyer. Siddho aham balavan sukhi. In this way, I am perfect. I am powerful. I am happy. And normally, happiness is not enjoyed alone. If we are the wealthiest person in the world, we may have some happiness. But if we are the only person in the world, then who will we show our wealth to? So the next verse describes that although that person wants to eliminate enemies, that person still wants admirers. Adyo abhijanvan asmi. Just see how I'm surrounded by so many aristocratic people who respect me. And then, ko anyo asti sadrusho maya. Who is there like me in this world? So this mentality is actually the mentality to be God. Because it is described as a murtha. It's only one person is there who is not, for whom there is no one equal to him or superior to him. And that is God. But when somebody thinks there is no one like me. Now all of us have some speciality. And all of us are unique in our own ways. But that uniqueness is our individuality. It is not our superiority over others. It's a difference. Each one of us is unique, but that is our specialness. That's not our superiority over others. Just because we are individuals, we are separate. We have our characteristics. But here, person wants to push others down and prove one's superiority. And Krishna tells, such a mentality is, says, that people, after they do all kinds of vicious things, then they put on a little show of religion. Yakshe dasya mimo disya. They perform some yajnas. They give some charity. And then people clap and appreciate, oh, you're such a charitable person, you're such a religious person. Modisha. They get some joy. Itte agyana vimohitaha. Such a mentality is the mentality of those who are deluded by ignorance. Agyana vimohitaha. It's interesting. Agyana and moha. What is the difference between the two? Ignorance and illusion. You could say ignorance means to not know. And illusion means to know something to be the opposite of what it is. For example, if we are driving and our eyes are blindfolded, then we can't see anything ahead of us. But if we have got cataract or if we've got some other eye defect, by which we see distances distorted. We see this car is far away, but it's actually very close. Or that speed bump is close by and we think it's very far. So then that is deluded vision. So Krishna is, so we could say, illusion is ignorance square. Ignorance means we can't see, but illusion means we can't see and we don't even know that we can't see. To be blind is a problem, but to be not aware of one's blindness is an even bigger problem. So agyana vimohitaha, Krishna says, such people are deluded by the demoniac, by these demoniac attitudes. And now, why am I talking about this? If you look at the whole context of the Bhagavad Gita is spoken before the Kurukshetra war is about to happen. And sometimes in a class, say, or in a public gathering, some person starts describing some kind of mentality. You know, some people do like this. And they start describing what this has been like. Now they don't mention the name, but everybody knows who they are talking about. They make it such a way that I didn't mention anyone's name, but everybody understands. So from context, sometimes if a particular statement is being made, even if the statement is not specific, we can infer about what it is being referred to. So now we could very well say that Krishna, when he's talking about this, he could very well be thinking about Duryodhana. Duryodhana had this greed, I want the kingdom. And he was thinking, I'm going to eliminate the Pandavas, and I'm going to sideline everyone else, and I'm going to get the kingdom. So of course, this mentality is not limited to Duryodhana alone. It very well applies to Ravana also. And Ravana, had a sister who, what was her name? Yeah, Shurapanakha. Now, Shurapanakha married another powerful demon. This demon was also quite powerful, but Ravan wanted to form an alliance with him. And thus he got his sister married to him. And that demon's name was Dushtabuddhi. So, he was, as his name suggested, he was a demoniac. So, he had a wicked mentality. So, Ravan formed an alliance, and in the past, when marriages were done, marriages were not just between two people. It was all for, especially in royal families, it was for forming alliances. And in this case, now, even among demons, there are dissensions, there are differences of opinion, there can be fights. So he wanted to get Dushtabuddhi to become a member of his own family so that he would not be a competitor. He would give him a share of the royal power, but he would not be a competitor. But then, Ravan would go for some fights himself, and he had to fight with some kings or some other rulers of the universe, and some he would send Dushtabuddhi. And he found that Dushtabuddhi was extremely powerful. And whichever war he sent into, Dushtabuddhi crushed his opponents. And he, as he grew, as Dushtabuddhi came after one after another victorious, Ravan started becoming insecure. And then, when he became insecure, he arranged for a whole conspiracy. He sent Dushtabuddhi out to fight against a formidable king. And then, he told the commander under Dushtabuddhi that when Dushtabuddhi goes ahead, you don't assist him. And Dushtabuddhi was slaughtered over there. And afterwards they went ahead and they defeated the enemy. And then they portrayed it as if Dushtabuddhi had been martyred. That he was such a great hero that he was killed in war. And naturally when Shurapanakha came to know about this, she was devastated. But soon rumors started trickling in that Dushtabuddhi had not been killed on the war by the enemy. Dushtabuddhi had been killed by the plan of his own king. And as Shurapanakha heard about this, and she was also a Rakshasi, she also had shrewd intelligence. She knew about the cruel nature of demons, including her own brother. First, she couldn't believe it. How can my own brother make me into a widow like this? But then, as she inquired more, as the rumors started trickling in, she became convinced that Ravan has arranged for my husband to be killed so that he would become the unchallenged ruler. And she felt infuriated by that. Now, she alone had no power by herself to take revenge. So, she decided she has to find some way by which she can take revenge. And she became mad. She became mad, first of all, because she had lost her husband, and secondly, because she had been betrayed by her brother. And then, she just couldn't bear to stay in Lanka. And then she left Lanka and she came nearby to Janasthan. Janasthan was the outpost of Lanka in the southern part of India. And there she was staying with her brothers, Kar and Dushan. And she would wander about in the forest. And whichever being she would see, she would, any animal which is of animal of prey, she would pounce on it and brutally kill it. And then devour it. So, she was naturally a Rakshasi, but because of her situation, she became extremely cruel. And she would wander around, and Kardushan also knew that she was powerful in her own way. So they would also let her wander around. And then, as she was wandering like this, she was wandering and suddenly she smelled something which is unusual. She smelled the smell of human beings. Now, in the animal kingdom, different animals have been endowed with different sensory skills. And many animals, they detect their prey by smell. And many animals even detect their predator. A deer may detect the presence of a tiger also by smell. So, by smells, when she detected, oh, she thought. Now, when we eat food, there are some items which are regular. You say dal rice, sabji, chapati, that's regular. But some items are special. If we have sweet rice, if we have dosa, we have some items that are special. So for her, human flesh was a special delicacy. And she said, oh, humans. Immediately her mouth started watering. And she immediately sneaked by. And as soon as she sneaked by, she came in Dandakaranya. And she came in Tapovan. Yeah. So there in the Dandakaranya, she came and Lakshman had formed a kutir over there, a small cottage. And there's a clearing in the dairy. So she sneaked by and outside she took stock. She saw Ram and Lakshman. First her eyes went to Ram. And as soon as she saw Ram, Ram was so powerful, so handsome. She had such a regal presence that immediately her desires changed. Now her lunchbox became her affair, her object of having an affair. Immediately, see, when our desires are not guided by dharma, then our desires can change drastically and then our actions can change drastically. Actually, something similar happens later in the Mahabharata also. When the Pandavas are in the forest for the first time, after they have been saved themselves from Varanavat forest, then Hidimbi sees Bhima. Now, when she sees Bhima, she is also attracted to him. So, she has also come first to eat, to get human flesh. She has been sent by her husband. So, not her husband, her brother. Hidimba, now go and find out what is there. And then she comes and she is attracted to Bhima. And now, of course, she does not in any way attack. Like Hidimba comes and attacks over there. And then Bhima overpowers Hidimba. And then Hidimbi, she very fervently begs first to Yudhishthir and then to Kunti. Then Hidimbi and Bhima get married and they have a son. Who is that?
Ghatotkacha.
So that's a different situation. Hidimbi never has any malevolent intention towards Bhima or any of the Pandavas. Now, in the case of Shurapanakha, however, now because her husband has also died quite some time ago, she also is unsated. She also has her desires. And then when she approaches Ram, at one level, initially, she thinks, oh, so Ram will satisfy me. Now, when there are generally in the past times, when the marriages that happen, they happen in the same species. So normally, say the Pandavas marry Draupadi, Ram marries Sita. But in some cases, the marriages may happen across species also. When such happen, at that time, if we see the Pandavas, when Bhima marries Hidimbi, or Arjun marries Ulupi, who is a Gandharvi, who is a Nagakanya, then in those cases, generally, those marriages, they live together till they have a child. And generally, in other species, the Devatas and the Asuras are similar in that the children grow up quite fast. And then because there is such a, you could say, cultural difference between the two species, so it's understood that they're not going to stay together for a long time. Once she has a child, the child will be there with the mother. And then periodically, Ghatotkacha and his mother would come to meet the Pandavas. Arjun, when he went later to scout, to win to get tributes, he met his son and his mother, his son and his wife. But so here, when Shurapanakha, she came, her idea was she wanted to have her desire satisfied. And she came to Ram. But in her case, she was already quite rootless. Rootless in the sense that she felt betrayed by her husband. And she was staying with Kharbhushan. But she also knew Kharbhushan is not going to go against Ram. Against Ravan. So she was in a very agitated state of mind. And she first approached Ram. Now she realized that as a Rakshasi, she will not be able to approach Ram. Ram would see her as an enemy. So she changed her form. And she transformed herself into a very attractive woman. And when she became this attractive woman, then she approached. Now, in Krishna Lila also, there is a demoness who takes a very attractive form. Who is that? Bhutana, yes. Now, Bhutana also comes in. Normally, though we don't see, we can't immediately see people's heart. We see people's appearance. And the more demoniac we are, the more stock we put on people's appearance only. None of us can actually see anyone's heart right in the beginning. So our first impression will always be based on people's appearance. But as we interact with people more, then we need to go beyond the appearance and then look at the substance. But for some people, if they are in extreme bodily consciousness, then they look only at the appearance and then never look beyond to the substance. So if we see this is the weakness, as the more bodily consciousness means that the more people are attracted to the body, and the body is the source of pleasure. The word asura, there is a Sanskrit meaning of that. That asura. Sura is one who are godly. Asura are those who are godly, ungodly. Now, that is one kind of etymological meaning. Sometimes some words, they are given just for illustrating certain meanings, some imaginative etymological analysis. Imaginative means that is not how the word has originally or originated. But that is also another way of understanding. So, asura, if we separate it into ashu and ra. Ashu means kutri. And ra means enjoyment. So, ashu, asura means those who want quick enjoyment. So they only look at the surface of things. Something looks enjoyable, they just rush for it. This is how, actually, when the Lord appears as Mohini Murti, he deludes the demons. Because he's very attractive. So those are demoniac. They just look at other people's appearances. And they also think that if I have an attractive appearance, if I can put on an attractive facade, I can also captivate others. So similarly, so Putana also does the same thing, Shurapanakha also does the same thing. And then Shurapanakha comes in. And then she approaches Ram. And she straight propositions him. And she says that, I'm attracted to you and let us unite. And then Ram, just the day after he gets married, at that time, the kings would sometimes have many wives. But Ram, the day after he gets married, he tells Sita, what wedding gift can I give you? He says, I have you, that's all that I want. I don't want anything else. He says, I'll give you a wedding gift. He says that you will be my only wife. And that's when he takes a ekapatni vrata. So, when he does that, at that time, now when Shurapanakha comes over here, he says that actually I'm already married to Sita. He doesn't tell her that I have taken a ekapatni vrata. Because, see, generally, when we are discussing something with someone, we have to bring forth the point that will make the most sense to them. If you tell a demon, I have taken this word of honor, forget your honor. what is the big deal about the word of honor? So, Ram doesn't mention that to her. Generally, when we speak to anyone, we have to find out, even if you are trying to share Krishna Bhakti with someone, we have to find out which points in Krishna Bhakti will make sense to people. And we present that. In any discussion, any argument, any persuasion that we have to do, to find out, okay, I may have this many things with me, this many points to make, but which point will make sense to that person? And that depends on what are the interests of that person. So, there's the traditional Subhashita, which says that, basically, it's a Sanskrit verse which says that, even the most competent cloth salesperson will not be able to sell any clothes in an assembly of naked sadhus. If there are Nagna Babas, if there are some sadhus who are so renounced, at least they consider their renunciation has to be expressed externally, and they don't wear any clothes at all. They think that they wear only, they're called Digambara, they wear only their directions as their dress. So if somebody goes, a cloth salesperson, no matter how expert someone may be, they'll not be able to sell. So when Ram is going to talk with Shurapanakha, he's not interested in her proposal. But when he has to say no, he's very expert. He said, I have Sita already as my wife. He points to Sita. And he tells her that, if we unite, you will have to become the maidservant of Sita. And you are so powerful. You are so attractive. For you to become a maidservant will be so demeaning. Now, this is a language Shurapanakha can't understand. So, he has to. Whenever we speak in a language that people understand, then communication happens. And language is not just the language like English, Hindi, Marathi. Language is basically what people consider important. So, then Shurapanakha starts thinking, what to do? And then she looks around, and then she sees Lakshman. And Lakshman is also very attractive. Very powerful, very handsome. And then he looks around him and says, is he single? So he says, at least right now. So then immediately she approaches him. Now when she approaches him, at that time, he tells her, he looks at Ram. Now Lakshman is so totally devoted to the service of Ram that actually when Lakshman's wife Urmila wants to come with him to the forest, and he tells her that I will not be able to take care of you. I am there to take care of Ram and Sita. He says, no, you don't have to take care of me. I will help you in taking care of Ram and Sita. He says, no, if you are there, I will be worried about you. I will have concern for you. She says, no, you won't have to worry anything about me. Now then, Lakshman also is very important. Then he tells Urmila that, actually, I am conflicted right now. Because, I have to serve my older brother, but I also have to serve my parents. But I cannot be at both places. So therefore, you stay at home and you serve my parents. And I will stay in the forest and take care of my brother. Then finally she agrees. So Lakshman has no intention of accepting any proposals from Shurapanakha. But when he sees Ram, when two people know each other very well, then just by a little expression of the eyes, little gesture, little signal from the eyes, a little expression on the face, you can read the other person, what the other person is doing. So without any verbal communication, Lakshman understands that Ram is just trying to playfully end this proposition. So he also goes along with a playful mood and he tells her that actually if we unite, then I am a servant of Ram and Sita. You will have to also become the servant of all of them. I don't want to become a servant of any. She has come there to be the enjoyer. She wants to be the enjoyer. She doesn't want to be a servant of anyone. So then she starts looking. She has faced a no from both of them. Now she feels very humiliated by that. And at one level, her psychology is understandable. So for a woman herself to approach someone and then to be rejected. It's quite hurtful. But still, everyone, no matter how hurt we have to respond in a proper way, in a proportionate way. Generally, if we are hurt, say, if you're walking along a road and somebody steps on us, now naturally we'll feel hurt. We just push them off. Don't hurt me. Now, if somebody is very vengeful, he'll go there and stamp on their foot. You stamp on my foot, I'll stamp on your foot. If somebody is so angry, how dare you step on my foot? They take out a knife and stab that person. That is outrageous. Such a small thing, you cannot do that. So, generally, our response has to be proportionate to the action that the other person is doing. But sometimes, when we become driven by our emotions, then our response becomes proportional not to the action, but to our emotion. And then one can act in extremely disproportionate ways. This is what happens in the Mahabharata also, when Arjun goes to the heavens, and there Urvashi proposes to him. And Arjun says, no. He says, you are like a motherly figure for me, because you were the wife of my ancestor, Purura. She says, no, these rules don't apply to me. But he says, no, they may not apply to you, but they apply to me, because I don't belong to heaven, I belong to the earth. And she is a apsara, she is such a damsel, she is such an attractive person that people beg for her favor. And when she herself comes to Arjun and Arjun refuses, she becomes so angry, she is a heavenly being. So, although the asuras and devatas, both of them are powerful, but the devatas are given power by which they can bless and they can curse. The asuras, they can't curse, they are themselves a curse. By their very existence, they bring misery upon people. Asuras are demons. So then she curses Arjuna. And the curse is that she doesn't, you have refused to satisfy me, you acted in an unmanly way, so you lose your manliness. And then, although that's a very great curse for a Kshatriya, but it works out to his favor. Because in the Ajnatavas, he acts as Bruhanalla, a person of third gender, by which he is not detected. But in this, so the point I'm making is that in this situation, when somebody experiences a rejection, then that person's reaction can be disproportionate. So in her case, I think Shakespeare has said, there is no anger in the world, there is no rage in the world as the rage of a woman scorned. So the British thinker, either Shakespeare or Francis Bacon, somebody else has said that. So anyway, so Shurapanakha becomes angry. Start thinking, she has seen Ram as a potential object for satisfying her desire. She's also seen Lakshman as an object for satisfying her desire. She says, neither has satisfied her desire. And why? She somehow uses her own logic, says Sita is in the way. Ram is not coming to me because of Sita. And he says, I have to get Sita out of the way. And all her sweet, charming appearance, in one moment it disappears. She just pounces on Sita and tries to strangle her. And now Sita has also been observing what is going on. Suddenly out of the blue, when this is a demoness, she's extremely powerful. She holds Sita in a death grip. She can just strangle and kill Sita. So Ram immediately tells Lakshman, stop her. And then Lakshman, in an immediate instinctive reaction, takes out his sword. And he doesn't want, even in that moment, he could actually kill her. And she was trying to murder somebody who was trying to protect. So he could have done that. But he decides just to stop her. And to stop her, he lops off her nose. Now she is a powerful demoness, but Lakshman's sword is also powerful. And as soon as she feels that wound, she feels the nose cut off. Now she just falls back in anger. Now in Hindi, naak kat jana. That is a sign of humiliation. We use figuratively, Because in the face of a person, the nose is considered to be one of the prominent features. And if the nose is cut off, then the person becomes disfigured. So it is not just disfigured, but also dishonored. So literally disfigures, figuratively dishonors. She becomes enraged. She just runs off. Now when her nose is cut off like that, she realizes that she's not a match to both of these brothers. So she immediately runs to her brothers. And she gets current to, she incites them. This is what they've done to me. How dare they do this to you? And they come out. And then they come out and attack. Shurapanakha, she tells that you kill all three of them, and after you kill them, you hand over their bodies to me. And he said that I will feast on their dead bodies. That's her plan. So this is Ravana's plan also. Ravana says that he tells Sita that if you later when Ravana abducts Sita and Sita refuses to voluntarily submit to him, he says, I'll give you 1 year period. He says, I am going to enjoy you. If you don't submit voluntarily, then if I don't enjoy your body sensually, I will enjoy it with my tongue. You don't have a big body, so I'll eat you for breakfast. So Shurapanakha has a similar plan for the brothers, Ram and Lakshman. But then, when she's observing, ask her Dushan along with the commander Trishara attack, and she finds that every one of them is just effortlessly killed by Ram alone. Lakshman also doesn't come to fight, because Ram tells Lakshman is Rakshasa, deceptive. So you stay by the side and guard Sita, because if they somehow come in and capture Sita and they hold Sita hostage, then we will become paralyzed, we will not be able to fight. So Ram alone fights. He overpowers all of them. When Shurapanakha sees this, she is outraged. She's first aghast. What is this? What kind of man is this? How can he kill all? She's of course grief-struck to see her brothers being killed. But she's frustrated because her desire to enjoy Ram is not fulfilled. Now desire to take revenge against Ram is not fulfilled. And her brothers are killed. And she's in this mad tumult of emotions. Then she just runs away from there. She doesn't know where to go, what to do. As soon as she's injured, she goes to Karandushan. But when Karandushan are killed, she doesn't immediately go to Ravan. Because there is still that tension between her and Ravan. And first Akampan, who is a general who survives Ram's onslaught. Because he does not fight Ram, he just watches and then he flees. He reaches Ravan first. Shurapanakha is just wandering. What to do? She's crazed. And then she hatches a plan. And her plan is that she says that I want to get back against Ram and Lakshman because they have rejected me and humiliated me, and I want to get back against Ravan. Because he has made me a widow. If I can create an enmity between the two of them, if Ravan wins, I will get revenge against Ram and Lakshman. But she thinks that Ram and Lakshman are so powerful, they kill Karandushan, they will kill Ravan also. If they kill Ravan, then I will get my revenge against Ravan. Because either way, I'll be the winner. So, in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, both places, there are people who have their own, as they say, access to grind. They have their own agendas, and then they act as if they are giving good counsel. So, who is the person who sets fires in the Mahabharata? Shakuni. Yes. Shakuni sets fires. So similarly, in the Ramayana, it is Shurapanakha who does like that. So initially, when Akampan goes and tells what has happened, Ravan is furious and he says, I am going to kill this impudent human. And Akampan says, His power is formidable. Better leave him alone. Then he's still thinking about it. He decides to go to marriage. He wants to, he decides, I have to take revenge. How can I not take revenge? So he thinks, if I cannot face him face to face, I'll plan something else. So he goes to Marij to ask him for some assistance. Marij can create some illusion. Marij tells him, Marij, when he hears the name of Ram itself, he is filled with fear. He's, in fact, the Ramayana says that just if Marij is so fearful, just hears the syllable R, he becomes fearful. So then he tells Marathi, which enemy of yours has advised you to fight against Ram? Now he's also intelligent. Now if you tell somebody, don't do this, who are you to tell me you don't do this? So it's generally when we have to persuade people, it's very important that we present things in a way that doesn't come off as insulting to that person. Disrespect to that person. So when I was learning public speaking, maybe 20, 25 years ago, I'm still learning, but when I was initially learning, so one of the principles they told us is that if you're speaking something and you feel the audience is not understanding, never ask them, do you understand? Because who will want to admit I don't understand it? It's insulting to oneself to say, I don't understand what you're saying. So, a better way to say it is, am I making myself clear? So, if we say that, okay, this is not clear, okay, then we can explain. So, Maricha is also intelligent. He doesn't say, don't do this. He says, which enemy of yours has advised you to do this? So then, when he tells about his Ram's power, and he says that, actually, this Ram, he shot me long ago with a blunt arrow. And that blunt arrow was shot with such force that I was thrown a long, long distance away. And since then, I've been living in fear that that blunt arrow will be followed by a sharp arrow afterwards. So, he says, don't antagonize Ram in any way. So then he just comes back. But then Shurapanakha comes over there. And when Shurapanakha comes, she just tells a completely different story. When she tells the story that recently some devotees asked me to write a biography of a senior devotee. And when I started inquiring, I had written about 20 books I have written on different, 25 books almost on different subjects. But now I've written a biography. When I started looking about how biographies are written, one of the things I realized is that in history, writing history is extremely difficult, because if you ask two people what happened, they can give completely different narratives. In one narrative, it will appear as if this person is so good, and this person, and that person is all problematic. And then if you tell the other person, this person, I'm so good, that person is so terrible. So, it's almost if you have to write history, it's almost like you have to, before you can write history, you have to become a detective. And find out who is saying right, what is right and who is saying, what is wrong and what who is saying. So, that's why generally, if anybody comes and tells us something, this person did like this, this person did like this, this person did like this, it's extremely important to hear the other side of the story. Before we pass judgment. Now, it's not that, now, in Shurapanakha's case, she was intentionally biased. Sometimes some people may not be biased at all. But it's just that, you know, we all perceive things from one perspective. And we just can't perceive things. It's a human limitation. We can try to understand things from the other perspective. But by default, we'll perceive things from our perspective only. So sometimes it's just unconscious, and sometimes it's conscious. So in her case, it was conscious. So, it's a matter of just the same point. If you make in a slightly different way, the meaning can get completely changed. say, if somebody asks us say our opinion about some person, say, I want to give this person some responsible service, what do you think about it? We could say, okay, they had problems earlier, but now they're doing well. Or we could say, they're doing well now, but they had problems earlier. The facts are the same, but the sequence makes a complete difference. And they had problems, that doesn't matter, now they're doing well. They're doing well now, but don't get carried away by that. They had problems earlier. So the same, completely same facts, but just a different emphasis in writing or in speaking. When we speak, usually the point that we tell at the end of the sentence, that's what stays in people's mind. So if we say the negative part at the end of the sentence, that's what stays in people's mind. If we say the positive part at the end of the sentence, positive, that's what remains in people's minds. So Shurapanakha does her own, this is called in today's political languages, spin doctoring. She did a spin doctoring. Now that means she gave her own spin to the whole story. And she told Ravan, first she came and Ravan saw her disfigured and, who has done this to you? And she told, it is Ram who did this. She tried to goad Ravan by telling him, your own sister has been dishonored like this and you are sitting here doing nothing. Now Ravan couldn't very well just sit there like that. But he asked her, what happened? Why didn't they do like this? And then she told him, I had gone there, and then Ravan got excuses. Why did you have to go to them? you started it all, and you got punished. And then Ravan tried to wash off responsibility. But then, Shurapanakha came with a spin. Did you know why I had gone there? I had gone there for your sake.
For my sake?
Said, Ram and Lakshman have an extreme, Ram has an extremely beautiful wife, Sita. And when I saw her, I felt she would be the perfect queen for you. And I had gone there just to get her for you. Now, there are lies and there are white lies. White lies, when there are lies, there is maybe only 50% true, 50% false. There is 90% true, 10% false. There is 100% false. But the only truth is she had gone there. But the purpose why she had gone there, it is completely false. She had gone there for her own enjoyment. Ravan was not ever in her mind also at that time. She said, I had gone there to get her for you. And then she started describing more and more of the beauty of Sita. And as she started describing the beauty of Sita, Ravan started getting more and more agitated. And then the Bhagavad Gita explains how contemplation on sense objects destroys our intelligence. Dhyayato vishayan pumsaha sangasteshu pajayate sangat sanjayate kama kamat krodho vijayate krodhat bhavati sammoha sammohat smuti vibhrama smuti bhramashat buddhinasho buddhinashat pranashyati. So is that you just contemplate on the sense objects. So we look at something. Okay. When the contemplation happens, then, hey, that's nice. Sangasteshu pajayate. And then as we keep desiring, we keep contemplating, the desire becomes better. I want it. And that's nice. It's when I want it. And then, who says I can't get it? Kama krodho vijayate. So who says, who can stop me from getting it? Krodhat bhavati sammoha. Then even in the past we have got into a lot of trouble because of doing certain actions. But our sense of right and wrong, our sense of beneficial and unbeneficial, it's all swept away in an illusion. Sammohat smriti vibhrama. Then even if we have heard some past cautionary notes, some past stories, every culture there are caution notes. Don't be too greedy, don't be too lusty, don't be too angry. You've heard such, but all that smriti gets lost. Our experience, others' experience. Smriti brahmashad buddhinasho. Our intelligence is based on our remembrance. The remembrance is not necessarily about facts, necessarily, but it is about learning experiences. And buddhinashad pranashyati. We fall. Upanishati, we become destroyed. So if you consider a hill, on a hill, when if it's filled with snow, it's a cold area, it's wintery, and the hill slope is covered with snow. And on top, a small snow pebble is formed. And that snow pebble is there, it is so small that if a person is walking along, that person can just kick it with their toe and the snow pebble will fall apart. But then as it starts coming down, as it starts rolling down, it gains mass and it gains momentum. And as it gains mass and momentum, it becomes bigger and stronger. And by that time that snowball rolls down the ground, it might have become a giant snowball. The same person who by a flip of a toe could have crushed it, now that snowball can roll down and knock over that person, crush that person also. So similarly for us, at the stage of contemplation, the desire is just like a snow pebble. And it's nice. But when it starts rolling down from contemplation to captivation, then obsession, then irritation, who says I can snow? Then delusion. Then there is stupefaction. Who says it cannot? Then there is actually oblivion. You forget everything in the past. Then stupefaction. We lose our emptiness. And then there is self-destruction. So this snow pebble, as it goes down, 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 it becomes more and more difficult to stop it. So in this case, what Shurapanakha does is that she triggers by her descriptions the desire within. Sure, Ravana's mind, and then as she keeps describing, and Ravana already is a lecherous person, he's a lusty person. So as he keeps hearing, he becomes more and more agitated. And he becomes more and more agitated, the desire starts going down. The desire starts becoming bigger and bigger. And by that time, when it becomes a snow pebble, buddhinasharat. So he just, I must get it, whatever the cost. So today also we live in a world where we are exposed to so many objects and they trigger desires within us. And as if we allow ourselves unfiltered contemplation on the objects that the world shows before us, then our desires can also dominate us and they can overpower us. So when this happens, then Ravana says, I am going to get Sita. And then the whole conspiracy moves forwards. He uses Maricha, and Maricha is surprised to see Ravana come back again. And he says, I want you to help me get Sita. He says, but just now I told you that Sita, don't antagonize Ram. He said that I have not come here to get instruction from you. I have come here to give instruction. He just dismisses his objections. And then when Sita is abducted, at that time, now when Shurapanakha, the Ramayana does not describe much about her afterwards. So Shurapanakha, when the war happens, Shurapanakha does not come out to fight against Ram at all. So she observes, and eventually, when Ravana is killed, then at that time she thinks I'll be satisfied. But then Ravana doesn't fall alone. Her anger was only at Ravana. But Ravana is such a demon that he actually sends all his commanders and generals, everyone to fight first. And all of them are killed one by one by one. And when Shurapanakha sees her cousin's son's killed, her cousin's husband's killed, he's a whole dynasty getting destroyed. What did I do? And eventually, when Ravana is killed, she thinks that I got revenge. But she gets no pleasure by that. Because it has come at too great a cost. She's lost everything. Something similar happens to Shakuni also. Shakuni also has his agenda. Shakuni is a whole different character. I won't go into it too much. But Shakuni feels slighted because When Bhishma comes to ask for Gandhari's hand to be married to the Kuru dynasty, he expects that she will get married to the Kuru king. But then Bhishma feels that she is the first bride that he has got for his nephew, and then he offers her to Dhritarashtra. And he feels that Dhritarashtra is blind, Dhritarashtra is not going to become the king. So how dare he feel as if my sister has been deprived. And he decided that I will cause distress to Bhishma. And this dynasty which has deprived my sister of the pleasure of being a queen. And then when she puts on a blindfold on herself, he feels even more angry that she is reduced to blindness because of this match. Now Gandhari accepts her situation, but Shakuni manipulates. Shakuni doesn't accept. And what happens? Shakuni has several sons also. Uluka is one of his sons, and Uluka is killed. Shakuni is just killed on the 17th day. And Shakuni's Gandhar soldiers are also killed, his commanders are killed, his friends are killed. And finally, on the 18th day, Shakuni is also killed. So he loses everything. So when somebody tries to manipulate others, they don't heal by that. Sometimes we may know somebody's weaknesses and we may try to use that knowledge of their weaknesses to manipulate others. But using others' weaknesses against others doesn't make us strong. It is overcoming our own weaknesses that makes us strong. It is going inwards and overcoming what weaknesses we have. But neither Shurapanakha nor Shakuni ever do that. Shurapanakha, now what was her weakness? Yes, it was horrible that Ravan did something like that to her. But she, instead of trying to seek revenge and create conflict, it simply aggravated things. Ultimately, the whole Rakshasa dynasty was destroyed. So if we want, we all have certain weaknesses, and if we live in a community, we live in a family, then over a period of time, we also come to know other people's weaknesses. And we may start using their weaknesses to fulfill our agendas. Now, actually, if we know other people's weaknesses, we should protect them from their weaknesses. Not that use their weaknesses against them. It's just like, we sometimes think that I have to get this person down so that I can go up. But instead we see that we are all together, we are all in the same boat. And if the boat sinks, it may be that one person sinks later and we sink later. One person sinks first and we sink later. But we are all going to sink. So if we, rather than trying to exploit other people's weaknesses, if we work on overcoming our own weaknesses, then we will become better. Exploiting others' weaknesses and fulfilling our agendas may give us a sense of success and power, but it will never give us satisfaction. However, overcoming our own weaknesses is what will truly give us satisfaction. And Shurapanakha, unfortunately, never gets that, and she lives a very devastated life when her whole kingdom is destroyed, and she knows that it's because of my own manipulations. So through Shurapanakha, actually, what is learned over here? There are many different points which could be learned. But the important thing is that manipulators never gain. Manipulators, they end up losing. Because when somebody becomes manipulative, over a period of time, people also understand this person manipulative. Nobody trusts the manipulator. And then they just become lonely, they become isolated. And ultimately, we are all actually being manipulated by time. Time is sending us all towards death. So we can manipulate and control others, but how much is the use of manipulating anyone? Because we are ourselves, Bhagavatam gives the example that just as wind pushes a cloud, and the cloud cannot resist. So the wind is pushing a cloud, similarly we are all being pushed by time towards death. Now this example indicates that the cloud is big and visible, the wind is invisible. Although the wind is invisible, its force is inexorable. It's not resistible at all. She'll just keep pushing. So rather than trying to manipulate and control others, we understand that we are all being ourselves pushed by inexorable time. And if we focus on connecting with Krishna, on strengthening ourselves by connecting with Krishna, then we can come out of this world where even if nobody is consciously manipulating us, we are being pushed in certain directions against our will by the forces of time. But by devoting ourselves to Krishna, we can rise beyond whatever weaknesses we have, and we can ultimately rise beyond the force of time, and we can attain Krishna's eternal abode where there is no manipulation, there is simply pure eternal loving reciprocation. I'll summarize. I spoke today about Shurapanakha's manipulations and started by talking about how the divine and demoniac, this is not just a physical type, it's a psychology, it's an attitude. And the demons, the Rakshasas, are a type of demons who don't just have demoniac mentality, but they also have a man-eating attitude. They're cannibals. And Shurapanakha, she was manipulated, or rather her husband was manipulated, Dushtabuddhi, and that's why he was sidelined. He was sidelined and eliminated by Ravan. I talked about the demoniac mentality, how everybody has greed, but greed to the extent of murdering others. That is what is very demoniac, and that's what Ravan had, Duryodhana had. So that's what Ravan did with Dushtabuddhi. And in Shurapanakha, in her madness, she wanted revenge. So she, when she saw Rama and Lakshman, when she smelled human spell first, she thought, I'll get some delicacy to eat. But when she saw Rama and Lakshman, she had to propose to them. But when she was rejected, naturally the sting of rejection will hurt. But her reaction was far more disproportionate. She just tried to kill Sita, strangle Sita. And Lakshman stopped her by cutting off her nose. She felt humiliated. And she tried to incite Karan Dushan, but when they were killed, she initially went mad with anger and grief, but then she hatched a scheme that I will get a win-win situation if I can incite Ravan against Ram. That if Ravan wins, I'll get revenge against Ram and Lakshman for disfiguring me. If Ram and Ram wins, then I'll get revenge against Ravan for making me a widow. But her manipulation, to manipulate Ravan, what did she do? She spun her own story that she had gone for getting Sita for Ravan. That is complete false. And she incited Ram. We talked about how contemplation is like a snow pebble forming. And then the more we contemplate, the snow pebble becomes bigger and bigger till it becomes like a snow boulder, just knocks down people completely. So like that, Ravan's intelligence was destroyed. And although Shurapanakha eventually got her revenge against Ravan, but it came at a far bigger cost, that the whole Rakshasa dynasty was destroyed. So we don't become stronger by exploiting other people's weaknesses. We become stronger by overcoming our own weaknesses. We're all being manipulated by the power of time pushed towards inexorable death. And the best way to overcome it is by rising beyond time, by practicing bhakti, connecting ourselves with Krishna and going beyond this world of manipulation, the world of eternal ecstatic reciprocation. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Any questions or comments? Yes, please.
So what Shurapanakha should have been done to satisfy, no? Although she got angry. So how? What might have been better?
With
action?
Whom? With her anger, Ravan or Ram or what?
Ram. She is angry with his brother. So what she might have done instead of what
the best
has she done?
Take revenge.
Best, yeah.
Okay. So if she has, she feels angry with Ravan, what could she have done? It's a difficult question. Sometimes in life, when we have been wronged, we may feel that it is our responsibility to punish the wrongdoer. And it's been many movies and novels are about that. You did this, the whole movie is about a revenge saga. You did this to me and I'll get back to you. But then, that revenge saga never ends. One person did this to another person, that person did this to another person. Goes on generation after generation after generation. So, if we are in a position of power, or if there is a rule of law where we can seek justice from someone, then we can, if we have been wrong, if we have the power and the inclination, then we can seek redressal for the wrong. See, justice is ultimately always done because the law of karma always works. And even if we don't take revenge, somebody else, by the law of karma, people will be punished for what they have done. Some people say that an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Now, if you hurt me, I'll hurt you back to that extent. But actually, if everybody starts following an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, most of the world will soon become blind and toothless. Now, this does not mean that just anybody can do any wrong and it has to be forgiven. See, basically, when somebody has done something wrong and they have to be punished for that, what is the purpose of punishment? Broadly, we can say there are three purposes. One is that the wrongdoer needs to be curbed from doing something similar again. The victim's suffering is taken seriously and a proportionate suffering is given. Not so that just to take revenge, but it is in any society there has to be a system of regulation. And if a victim is told just forgive whatever that, that means you're not taking their suffering seriously. And third is an example has to be set for the rest of society. See, if there's a victim and a victimizer, there's a victim, victimizer, and there's the rest of society. So the victimizer has to be stopped, the victim's pain has to be acknowledged, and society has to be instructed. So broadly, these three purposes are there. But these three purposes are not always in the hands of an ordinary person to do. Generally, it is the responsibility of the kshatriyas to do it. The kshatriyas means the rulers of society. So in the past, there were kings and kings who would be the judges also. Now we have the legislative system, the legal system for that. If somebody starts taking the law in their own hands, then that is called vigilante justice. You know, some people become vigilantes. You have done something wrong, I'll punish you outside the court. That can lead to chaos in society. So if we have the capacity to bring a lawbreaker to justice, we can do that, but not in a sense of a personal agenda. Not personal vendetta. When the Pandavas fought against the Kauravas, it was not to take revenge. It was to establish the law. If their purpose had been to take revenge, then they would not even have considered a peace proposal. They not only considered a peace proposal, but they actually had Krishna offer it on the most accommodating terms. So revenge was not the agenda. Ram was also not interested in revenge. Because he sent a message to Ravan that if you give Sita back, we'll forget everything. We'll just end everything. There's no need to carry this further. But Ravan was not ready to listen at all. So therefore, it's important that if we have the capacity to take some action against the wrongdoer, we do that. And the action is that in a proper legal way. So now in the case of her case, Ravan is the law. So what can she do? So at such times, we just have to move on with our own life. See that as a terrible chapter in our life. Maybe it's we did some karma in the past because of which we got that reaction. And we move on with our life. If we reduce our life to taking revenge against someone, then that vengeful mentality itself will become our enemy. Because our mind is a machine, is like a mechanical device. whatever emotion we hold on tightly in the mind, that emotion starts becoming our default emotion over a period of time. And even if somebody takes revenge against person X or person Y, person doesn't get relief because that vengefulness has become their default disposition. And then soon after that, they will find some other wrong which somebody else has done and they will take revenge against that. So that just becomes a vengefulness is not at all a healthy emotion. So if for establishing dharma, for having the law of order, for that purpose, if something we can do something, we can. Otherwise, just let it go and move on with our life. Yes.
So, like, based on the stories you mentioned, like, because they have chosen the path of taking revenge on the other person, like, it brought their own destruction. What would have happened if they have chosen the path of forgiveness?
By they mean Shurapanakha or whom?
Anyone. Anyone. Like, Shurapanakha, even like Shakuni, like, if they have chosen the path of forgiveness instead of, like, taking revenge.
Yeah, if they had chosen the path of forgiveness, things so much destruction could have been avoided. In general, there are some issues which can be ended by forgiveness. See, sometimes some people say, I will never forgive this. This is unforgivable. And some people say that I'll just forgive anything. We sometimes think of forgiveness as a utopian thing because we feel that how can I forgive somebody who's done something wrong? That's also understandable. So it's not that forgiveness is the solution to all problems. It is that if somebody overall has normally lives a respectable, honorable life, and then on one occasion they do something which we find terribly wrong, then holding that against them for the rest of their life, that is unnecessary. So now, it was not Bhishma had no intention of deliberately depriving Gandhari. He had no intention. Shakuni felt that if I have an alliance with the Kuru kingdom, my prestige will increase. So it was his problem. So he could just have overlooked that and Gandhari had accepted it and move on. So if something is a one-time mistake, then there is no need to hold it against other person. But if something is repeated, then we may not want to take revenge, but we have to protect ourselves from being hurt again and again by other person. So forgiveness doesn't mean that we let the other person do whatever they are doing, no matter how much it hurts us again and again. So there's a difference between forgiving someone and trusting someone. Forgiveness is for the past. Trust is for the future. So what you did in the past, I'm not going to hold it against you. But if somebody has hurt us terribly in some way, we can't open ourselves to them and again risk being hurt. So forgiveness can be given, but trust will have to be earned. And for that, they may have to act in a trustworthy way. And if they choose to act in a trustworthy way, then gradually the relationship can be restored to its former strength and a trust will come by that. So if in certain cases, it's an occasional wrong or imagined wrong, then just forgiving it and moving on in life can avoid a lot of unnecessary conflicts. But it has to be seen according to situation to situation. See, life doesn't come with a one-size-fit-all solution. There are certain situations when forgiving ends the matter. But sometimes in some situations, forgiving may perpetuate the matter. Because the other person starts feeling that, I can just go on doing this, no matter what you do. You are not going to do anything. And forgiving is not weakness. If somebody thinks of forgiving as weakness, then they are an illusion. That's why we need to separate forgiving and trusting. Actions need to have consequences. The consequences doesn't mean that we have to have an agenda to take revenge. But we do need to protect ourselves. So forgiveness is meant, first of all, to free ourselves from the vengeful mentality. My life is meant for better things. I don't want to just get back at you. But another thing is, forgiveness is also meant to help the other person become free from the defensive mentality. you did like this. No, I didn't do like this. It's not like that. Not like that. Just do. But the, if something wrong has been done, there has to be some attempt at least to prevent the recurrence of it. And that means that the person has to change. If they're not ready to change, then we might just have to decide, I'm going to keep a distance from here, and so that I don't want to be hurt again. So forgiveness can, in many situations, actually minimize conflicts substantially. Because in most of our close relationships, it's not that people have an agenda against us. It's not that people are malevolent. Whenever we're in a close relationship, we all want that relationship to give us shelter, satisfaction, strength. And even if sometimes somebody commits a mistake repeatedly, if it is not a very serious mistake, then there's no need to hold it against them. We understand this weakness this person has, and we learn to live with it. Don't harp on it. So, at least in close relationships, forgiveness can act as a very powerful you could say friction eliminating material. Like you can put some grease or something, when two parts rub against each other, they create a noise. So forgiveness can act as a grease which prevents unnecessary friction from producing too much noise. Any other questions? Oh, yes.
Why didn't Ram just punish Ravan and Sri Panka only? Why did he have to destroy like almost the entire Raksha dynasty? Because the soldiers were forced to, you know, fight him. If they deserted, then Ravan would certainly punish them. But if they fought, Ram would certainly kill them. So, I mean, why did Ram...
Yeah, good question. So, why did Ram not just punish Ravan straight? Why did he have to fight against the Rakshasa dynasty? See, Ram did not want to fight against anyone. Ram just wanted to protect Sita. And that's why let's end the past. He offered a peace proposal. He sent Angada first. Then Sugriva also went at one time before that. Hanuman himself also said, give Sita back. But Ravan did not listen. Now, as far as the soldiers were concerned, when Vibhishan was considering his options, Vibhishan very fervently requested, entreated, and even begged Ravan, just give Sita back. Otherwise, our whole dynasty will be destroyed. Then Ravan very derisively dismissed her and insulted Vibhishan. And Vibhishan contemplated that I have three options now. One is that, you know, that I can try to stage an internal coup, internal revolution, and overthrow Ravan and gain power and then hand Sita back and avoid this war. The other option is that I don't want to stand and be a mute witness to this terrible atrocity. I can just leave and I go to the Himalayas and take renounced order. And third, he says, now, for both these options, there are problems. Second, he felt it to be a responsibility for him because he was a part of the royal dynasty and he had a responsibility to his citizens. First, he realized that he did not have enough influence, enough followers to stage a successful revolution. Why? Because Ravan was extremely powerful and most people, they lived in fear of him. And they knew that if they were caught by making a coup like that, they would meet a very terrible death. And moreover, because Ravan had been successful, he had made the kingdom prosperous and he had not been defeated before. So, most of the soldiers thought that we are going to win. So, very few would actually want to go against that king. So they felt the only option for me left is, I have to go to the side of Ram and tell him that your enmity is not with the Rakshasas. It is only with a particular Rakshasa. And there are Rakshasa, within the Rakshasa ranks also, you have supporters. And thus when Vibhishan went to Ram's side, the first thing that Ram did was that Ram coronated Vibhishan as the king of Lanka. This was an outrageous gesture. outrageously confident. He says, the king is there, Ravana is the king. And he's already coronated the next king. But Ravana heard this, he was thunderstruck. It's like somebody is the prime minister, serving prime minister, and somebody else, you know, gives the vow of prime minister to someone else. What? So Ravana is thunderstruck. And then Ravana tries to downplay it. And he says, what is this? One beggar has coronated another beggar. He just dismisses it. But what Ram did by that is, he not only fully accepted Vibhishana himself, but by coronating Vibhishana as the king, he not only expressed his confidence that he was going to win, but that he had nothing against Lanka. He was not planning to destroy Lanka. He was not planning to annex Lanka. Annex means make it a part of Ravana's, Ram's kingdom only. He wanted Rakshasa only to rule. So Ram, in that sense, minimized the damage. There is no way at that particular situation which Ram would have challenged Ravana for a one-to-one duel, and Ravana would have agreed. If Ravana had been ready to agree to a one-to-one duel, why would he have even abducted Sita separately? Because he wanted to avoid a one-to-one confrontation. That's why he had gone behind his back to get Sita. So that option for a one-to-one confrontation was not there at all. So eventually, the Ramayana describes that after Ravana fell, then when Ram and the Vanaras entered into Lanka, they didn't plunder Lanka. They did not attack any of the citizens of Lanka. There was a very smooth transfer of power to Vibhishana. And then Vibhishana used the wealth and opulence of Lanka to take care of all the victims who were there on both sides, the Vanara side as well as the Rakshasa side. So basically the war was fought in such a way that a certain amount of violence was unavoidable. And Ram did not in any way maximize the violence but minimized it. Good question. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, okay.
Not directly with Shurapanakha, but yeah. In Ramayana, while he was killed by Rama, in a dubious manner, that's an extent. What is the anterior motive of this? What does it say?
Okay. Yeah. So, Ram was killed by, Ram killed Vali in a very dubious way. So, what was the reason for that? That can be understood at many different levels. First is that, let's look at what the Ramayana itself says. Vali himself was outraged when he was fighting with Sugreev, and Ram shot him from behind. And Vali actually says, this Sugreev is evil-minded. And he says, Ram, I had heard you are virtuous. It's by associating with Sugreev, you are also becoming evil-minded. So then Ram says, that now you acted as an aggressor against your own brother. In the Vedic culture, there is an understanding that if some normally if a war is to be fought, the war is to be fought among equals, and both of them have to be alert and they have to fight. But if somebody is an aggressor, somebody is a criminal, sometimes somebody is a normally if somebody is a criminal, they have to be arrested, they have to be brought before the court, and then they have to be tried and then they have to be punished. But if somebody is a terrible criminal, and the government may issue order to shoot at sight. So there is no, this person is a terrible criminal, and we can't have the normal process of bringing before the shoot at sight. So atatainas, those who are aggressors, are like that. There is a shoot at sight. That's allowed in extreme situations. So in the case of Vali, what was his crime? Generally, in a joint family setting, the older brother takes the place of the father, the oldest brother. So Sugreev served Vali just like he would have served their father, Rukshiraj. And Sugreev was always there with Vali to help him in every situation. But then, because of an unfortunate misunderstanding between them, Sugreev thought Vali had been killed. And Vali came back and Vali thought that Sugreev has usurped the kingdom from me. Then Vali did not give Sugriv any chance for clarification. Just attacked Sugriv and he drove him out of the kingdom. He took away the kingdom from him, took away royal comforts from him, and even took away Sugriv's wife. And that was almost like incest. Because I said the older brother is like a father. So Ram told him that you have committed a grievous crime against your brother. And as a servant of Bharat, who is the ruler of Ayodhya, I had to administer justice. And that's why I punished you. As an aggressor, because you are a grievous aggressor, you needed to be punished. Now, having said that, this is actually an elaborate argument. This is the major argument. But at the end of it, when Ram completes his argument, Ram tells Vali, if you feel after this that I have acted unfairly, now I will take out this arrow and I'll give you back your life. So, now along with that, this is a circumstantial reason. Circumstantial reason means that Vali had done something wrong. Another reason over there also was that Vali had got a benediction. And by that benediction, there are many people who try to seek immortality in different ways. Against anybody. So he had sought a benediction that if anybody fights against me, half of their power will come to me. So now what would happen by that is, anybody is fighting against them, he already has his own huge power and he gets half of the power of the opponent. And he will always become more powerful than his opponent. And that's how he had actually overcome Ravan also. And that's why Ravan had agreed to a treaty with him. So in that case, of course Ram does not have to follow any such law, because he is the giver of all power. He is not under it. But generally, if a devata or someone has given some power to a particular being, the Lord doesn't directly reject or violate that benediction. He honors that and he finds a way out through it. So, that was also a reason why Ram didn't directly confront Vali. Now, when Ram told Vali that, I can give your life back to you. So then Vali, actually his heart is transformed. At the back of his mind somewhere, he also knew that maybe I have done something wrong. Maybe I have not treated Sugriv fairly. And his wife, Tara, also told him, your brothers, end this conflict, get him back. But he never listened to her. So then, Vali's transformation is quite inspiring. Vali says that, deaths, we all get many. He says, lives I have got many, but a death like this in your presence is rare indeed. So he says, I will accept death. And then, not only does he accept death, he seeks forgiveness from Sugriv for whatever he has done. And then he has been blessed with a jewel necklace by his father, Indra. And he had a terrestrial father and a celestial father. So terrestrial father was Aksharaj and celestial father was Indra. So Indra had given him this jewel necklace, and because of that jewel necklace being present in his, so the jewel necklace had this prediction that that as long as anybody would be wearing the jewel necklace, that person would not die. So that's why although Ram's arrow was so powerful, Ram was an amoghasharam, his arrow never missed his target. But Vali was alive through it all. Then he took out his jewel necklace and he could easily have given it to Angad. And it would be expected, he was his son. But he wanted to atone for the wrong that he had done. Not atone, make amends for the wrong that he had done to Sugriv. And that's why he gave that necklace to Sugriv. And the moment that necklace left his hands, life left his body. So it was a very graceful end. Now Sugriv, Vali himself was the victim of that perceived injustice. And if Vali doesn't hold any grudge against Ram, Vali doesn't consider that what Ram had did was wrong, then he understands the situation much better than what we do. That's why we don't have to see that as a wrong from Ram. Okay. Yeah.
See, all this is one side from the Bali side. But other side is, Bali and Ravan had a pact.
Yeah.
That if you attack me, you consider the attack on me.
Okay.
And then the seed both of them join.
Correct,
so
yes. Correct.
So, if this has not happened, you get war. Bali will be with Ravan. Even to kill Ravan, Ram had to go through so much of power. And if Bali was with him, then the half of power of Ravan, Ram would have gone to him. No way in which Ram could have won. Strategically, Ram had to remove Bali from the war scene. So he had to find a means, explainable means. You understand? Strategically. A difficult position. You have to get out of it, pain. So he says, you are an animal, animals don't have this, all those arguments follow this. So this I feel is the one that explains why Ram had to do that. Maybe previous way of killing him. Because of strategy, there is no way out of it situation.
Okay, that's possible. Was it that Vali and Ravan had a pact? And if Ram had to fight against Vali and Ravan together, it would have been impossible. That's why Ram had to remove Vali. Well, it could be at that particular point, if we see in the Ramayana's narrative, Ram did not even know where Ravan was. Ravan's kingdom was in Lanka, but at that time we did not have Google Maps. So actually where Ravan was, they didn't know. Ravan's kingdom, where it was, they didn't know. And there is no clear knowledge at that particular point, at least the way Ramayana describes. You see, there are certain inferences we can make from certain situations, but those are, we are ascribing motives to certain characters. If we look at the characters themselves, then at that time, whether Ram even knew about the pact between Vali and Ravan, and whether Vali would come
no,
to the...
That is known because Sugri mentions that, apparently, because...
No,
who mentions this pact to Ram?
There is...
How does Ram come to know about this pact?
No, that's what I'm saying, that the first time that pact is mentioned in the Valmiki Ramayana is later when Ravan sends his messenger to Sugriva. And Ravan tells Sugriva, "No, Vali and we had a pact together. And we can continue our pact. I have not harmed you in any way. You just leave from here." So from my reading of the Ramayana, it is the Valmiki Ramayana, that is the first time that pact is mentioned. So later on, a posteriori, we can analyze in different ways. But at that point, Ram's primary purpose was to correct the wrong which had been done to Sugriv. And Sugriv had said that, "I will assist you in finding Sita." So that's all that we know. If you want to ascribe some further motives, then that is like we, using our analytical ability, we are not reading from the epic. We are reading into the epic. Reading from the epic means this is a text and this is what the text is saying. But reading into the epic means that we start reading certain things which are actually, they may not be there at all. And sometimes this kind of reading can lead to serious misunderstandings. I was in South India and that time I was giving a class and there somebody I raised a question. Somebody said that there's a message going on WhatsApp. Somebody said that, you know, if somebody wants to have a brother, let them have a brother like Ravan. And he was ready to lay down his life for his sister. Now, this is something which we are reading. Was Ravan ready to lay down his life for his sister, or was Ravan ready to lay down his life for Sita? You know? So, we may read certain things into scripture which may actually not be there. And what has happened is that because the Ramayana and the Mahabharata also to some extent, that these are very widely known books. And that's why many authors, when they want to write the Ramayana, or they want to write in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, they have to come up with something new. And they try to come up with some new analysis. And by their coming up with that new analysis, they try to sell their books. So, you know, I answer questions online. There's a website of question answers called Quora. So there I answer questions on the Mahabharata and the Ramayana. So the one question which had got the maximum views was that somebody had asked this question, did Draupadi love Karna? Now, it's completely absurd. Karna was the person who suggested that Draupadi be disrobed. So, now why would Draupadi love Karna of all people? But apparently several authors have imagined their own retelling of the Mahabharata with that idea that when she was being dishonored, she was thinking, oh, if only I had accepted Karna, Karna had been my husband, he would have protected. Now, this is not reading the Mahabharata. This is reading into the Mahabharata. It is, we are having our own ideas and we are reading into the Mahabharata. So, to some extent, such inferences might seem reasonable. But if they are from the progression and the characterization, if they are not actually tenable, then it's best not to make such inferences. We can talk more one-to-one afterwards. Okay. Thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki
jai,
Gaur Bhaktavinda ki
jai,
Gaur Premananda
ki jai, Hari
Hari Chaitanya Charan ki
jai,
Shri Prabhupada ki
jai.
Krishna mentioned in Bhagavad Gita,